If you look in your program, on the page 3, it says our mission statement. And we'd like for you to stand and join with us as we say together our mission statement. And we're going to ask Pastor Reinhardt to come and lead us.
When you found it, say amen.
Amen.
All together. Our mission statement. The mission of the Victory Ecumenical Church is to bring people to Jesus and membership in His family, develop them to Christ-like maturity, and equip them for the ministry in the church and life mission in the world in order to magnify God's name. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, if you go over to the next page, you will see our scripture reading. When you find it, say amen.
Amen.
This morning, we want to ask Sister Bell to read Acts 2. Sister Darby, will you read Psalm 104, please?
Yes, sir. Psalm 104, 24
through 34 and 35. O Lord, how manifold are your works. In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creations. Yonder is the sea, great and wide, creeping things, innumerable are there, living things, both small and great. There goes the ships and Leviathan that you form to sport in it. These all look to you to give them their food in due season. When you give to them, they gather it up. When you open your hand, they are filled with good things. When you hide your face, they are dismayed. When you take away their breath, they die and return to their dust. When you send forth your spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the ground. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. Who looks on the earth and it trembles? Who touches the mountains and they smoke? I will sing unto the Lord as long as I live. I will praise to my God while I have being. May my meditation be pleasing to him, for I rejoice in the Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Praise the Lord.
Amen. We ask, Reverend Sister read from the first day, would you read Romans?
Romans 8:22-27. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruit of the Spirit, groans inwardly, while we wait for the adoption and the redemption of our body. For in hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, but we do not know how to pray as we ought to. But the very Spirit interceded with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God, the word of God for the people of God.
Amen. Will we all stand for the reading of the Gospel of John? When the application comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf, and you and also are the testifier because you have been with me from the beginning. I did not say these things to you from the beginning because I was with you, but now I am going to him who sent me. Yet none of you shall ask me, where are you going? But because I have said these things to you, sorrow have filled your heart. Nevertheless, I'll tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away, for if I do not go away, the adversary will not come to you. But if I go, I will send to you. And when he come, he will prove the world wrong about sin and the righteousness and the judgment. Above, about sin, because they do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father, and you will see me no longer. About judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you in all the truth, for he will not speak on his own, but speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. Amen. May it add a blessing to the reading of God's word. You may be seated.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
What an exciting day.
Yes.
I have a special task now I want to share with you. As Christians, we don't ever glorify ourselves. We glorify the one that is in us. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
We don't go seeking attention. We don't call attention to ourselves. We don't even try to lift ourselves up and praise one another. Amen. But on this day, it is a special occasion, and we wanted to acknowledge what we call the Ecumenical Person of the Year. I said, well, what would a person have to be the Person of the Year? Well, that person would have to be not a person. That person would have to be a vessel where Jesus Christ resides. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
That person would have to be love epitomized. That person, when you see them, it just brings joy to your heart just to see them and be in conversation with them. That person couldn't be new to this. It would have to be a person that's seasoned deep in the word, in the written word, and in the word Jesus Christ. And so after much deliberation, just trying to outdo one another and describing this person, we decided that we would acknowledge her this morning. I would like to call the Reverend Dr. Hattie Mae Mickens,
amen,
the Ecumenical
amen
Person of the Year.
First of all, this morning I'd like to give honor to my Heavenly Father, to each and every one in your rightful, respectful place. I praise Father and I thank him for blessing me and allowing me to be here. Because there are so many other places I could have been, but I thank him that he allowed me to be here. And I give him glory, honor, praise, and I thank him. And I thank you for you all, how much you love me. I love you all too. So that's that. And I'd like to say again, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Amen.
Amen. Some of you are aware, please be seated, that in order to get some people to come to a program, you got to tell them that there's something special there for them. We don't have to do that with Mother Mickens. She's just here because she loves us. Amen. What a delight. I also want to share with you that we have a leadership award. Some of you may know that the Ecumenical Church is built on the principle of discipleship. It is built on the model of Jesus Christ. Our church is asking that every minister and every person would do as Jesus did, get 12 disciples and minister and train and disciple them in the way of the Lord, in the way of the word. And so this morning we want to recognize one who has done such. And he comes to us by way of difficulty, hardship, and trouble. Amen. I said all that to throw him off. Jacob Polka. Please, come on around.
Right.
We are so blessed.
Thank you.
Amen. This is a leadership award, and it says, the Lord himself watches over you. The Lord stands beside you as your protective shade.
Amen.
And in it, it has a tree. And we have given you this tree because maybe you are the trunk, and from this strong trunk come many branches. We believe that you epitomize what we are trying to do with the Ecumenical Church, where you have disciples that you are training to teach others to become disciples. And so we wanted to acknowledge your efforts here this morning and let you know, merci, 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 merci beaucoup.
Merci beaucoup. Que Dieu te bénisse.
May we, please.
Hallelujah. I don't even know what to say. I'm just going to say, praise the Lord. I'm just trying to do what the Lord asks us to do. And I'm trying to do it the best I can do. And if by doing it, I can get this, glory be to the Lord. God bless you all. Thank you, Pastor.
Amen. You'll be able to get videos of this program, and with Alex standing in front of the camera, you'll be able to see most of his head as much as Let us now to prepare to worship the Lord with our offering. We call for the ushers to come forth. Let us stand. Derek, I'm going to call on you again. Sister Jones is looking in her pocketbook.
What you need, God got it. My God got it. God, what you need, God, my God got it. Well, he's got it. Everything that you need, what you need, God, my God got it. What you need, God, my God's got it. Well, what you need, Lord, church, my God's got it. Well, he's got it. Everything that you need. If you need power, my God's got it, God. If you need power, church, my God's got it. Well, if you need power, church, my God's got it. Well, he's got it. Everything that you need. If you need healing, church, my God's got it. Well, if you need healing, I'm glad God's got it. Well, if you need healing, turn my God's got it. Well, he's got it. Everything, Lord, that you need. If you need the Holy Ghost, I'm glad God's got it. Well, if you need the Holy Ghost, I'm glad God's got it. If you need the Holy Ghost, tell my God's got it. Well, he's got it. Everything, Lord, that you need, what you need, I'm glad God's got it. Well, what you need, I'm glad God's got it. What you need, turn my God's got it. Well, he's got it. Everything, Lord, that you need. If you need power, I'm glad God's got it. If you need power, Godhead. Oh, if you need power, turn my God's Godhead. Well, he's got it. Hallelujah. Lord, Lord, that you need. If you need healing, turn my God's Godhead. Got him. Well, if you need healing, turn my God's got him. Touch, he's got him. Everything, Lord, that you bring. If you need the Holy Ghost, turn my God's got him. Oh, if you need the Holy Ghost, I'm glad God's got him.
Pray. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we thank you now. We thank you for your presence. We thank you, Lord, for allowing us all to be here. We thank you, Lord, for this offering. Bless those that gave in this offering. Bless those that wanted to give but did not have. May this offering be taken and used for the purpose which was taken for. For the building thy kingdom here on earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
It's time for the word. Today, we are blessed because we have an obedient servant.
Amen.
We're blessed today because we have a model of excellence.
Amen.
We're blessed today because I can give you the residence of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. In the Bible times, they asked the question, where does Jesus live? And in those times, they had difficulty answering. But this morning, I can tell you where my Lord and Savior resides. Our speaker today comes as a residence. Her heart is where Jesus lives. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Our speaker today is the Reverend Dr. Sylvia Mickens. And she would have me to make the distinction that she's Sylvia, Dr. Sylvia, and not Dr. Hattie. We want both of these doctors to know that we have confidence in both of them as doctors, healing doctors, amen? Because of the living Christ that lives in them. Dr. Mickens has served at Christ Central nearly 20 years. Acting out, living out Matthew 25. As soon as a person would get out of jail, Matthew 25, they would go to Christ Central to get something to eat. As soon as they're in a situation where they're foreigners, Hispanics, coming to this country, they would go to Christ Central to get directions and bearings on their life. We're so glad that our speaker today is not only intellectually gifted, but she is practically, ministeriously gifted. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
That she not only can talk the talk, walk the walk, but she can live the life. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
And so I want to present to some and introduce to others our speaker for this morning, Reverend Dr. Sylvia Mickens.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise, glory, honor, and thanksgiving to our God, Yahweh is his name.
Yes.
I thank you for being here. I thank the brother for singing that song.
Amen.
Yeah, sing it till I felt it. But if I was gonna sing a song this morning, I'm not.
Please, sing a song.
I'm not. It would be praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Amen.
Praise him all people here below.
Yes.
Praise him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Because you see, I can never thank him enough. I can never thank him enough. Because he's all I need and some more. He's been there for me when I didn't know he was there. And he's there for me all the time. And I don't have a shadow of a doubt that he's not going to leave me. Because he didn't bring me this far to leave me. So it is indeed a great pleasure to stand before you, and I humbly stand before you this morning to share a word from my God, my Savior. Father, thank you for this opportunity to stand. I'm graced because you graced me. I decreased that you would increase in me. When I speak today, it be with the Spirit and nothing of the flesh. You know who's in the audience, and you know what we, all of us, stand in need of. So speak to me and speak through me, so that what I say this morning will be a sweet smelling savor in your nostrils. I give you glory, I give you praise, I give you honor, and I give you thanksgiving. In the mighty name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, we have a lot of things going on here today. We are making history. We are a part of history, but we are also making history. We've got three things going on. We have the Global Day of Prayer. Prayer being united all over the world. Christians all over the world are gathering this day, some of them right now, and they are praying. We had prayer here this morning. So God's got everybody's attention all over the world. I think that's powerful. And guess what? We are part of that. The Global Day of Prayer. We also have 20-year celebration of the Ecumenical Church of Christ. Not just the Ecumenical Church, but the Ecumenical Church of Christ. And I just want to share with you that the number 20, because see, when you've got a church that's been in operation for 20 years, somebody's been doing some praying.
Amen.
Somebody's been doing some crying.
Yeah.
It's a whole lot of things have been going on, but somebody has also survived. So the number 20 corresponds with the Hebrew letter Kaf, K-A-F. And some people spell it K-A-P-H. It sounds the same. But it simply means productivity. It means fruitfulness. It means teaching. It means doctrine. Does that sound like a church? But most of all, it means covering. And when I got to that word covering, I said, yeah, that is the ecumenical church, because so many other churches require so much before they cover you. But Bishop Redford will cover you. Now, whether you cover yourself is up to you. But the bishop will cover you. He will give you a platform. He will give you an opportunity to live out what God has put in you. He will give you the opportunity to walk out the gifts and the calling that God has given you. So we are celebrating 20 years of the Ecumenical Church covering and saying you can come in here when everybody else say you don't qualify. We're also celebrating Pentecost Sunday. Wow. Pentecost Sunday is also known as Shavuot. That's another one of those Hebrew words for weeks. It's been 7 weeks, y'all, since Passover, or as most of us know it, Easter. It's been 7 weeks. Today, yesterday was 49 days. Today is the 50th day. And Pentecost simply means 50. That means on the day of Pentecost, they waited. They waited for God to show up. He made a promise that he was coming. He was going to endue them with the Holy Spirit, that he was going to fill them with the Holy Spirit. And I wish I could stand here and say everybody in Jerusalem waited that day, but everybody was not in the upper room that day. But for those that waited and for those that were in the upper room, they were filled with the Holy Spirit. So this is kind of like the birthday for the church. Because it was after the Holy Spirit came that the church began to actually operate and walk out the doctrine under the apostles. So we've got a lot to celebrate today. We have a lot going on. And guess what? We are part of it.
Yes.
Are you excited?
Yes.
Are you excited? I wasn't the Dr. Mickey's that he called this morning, but I'm excited. I'm delighted to be a part of this movement.
Yes.
Just to be a part of what's going on. I'm excited to be here with you.
Yes.
Okay. So for that reason, I believe that, you know, if I had to get a topic for my word today, I think that a fitting theme for our message today would be simply the power of prayer. The power of prayer. Prayer is a gift that comes from God. So many times we get gifts and We don't want them. I know in my family, we re-gift. If I can't use it, I'll give it to somebody else. We do that with gifts and cards, y'all. We re-gift, but so many times you get a gift and it's just not quite the right gift. It's just not what you want. So you'll either put it on the shelf. If you're smart, you'll re-gift it and give it to somebody else who can use it. But prayer is a gift. And through that gift, we learn to receive from God. We learn to experience God himself because there's communication. There's communion. But we also learn to return his love in the relationship. You know that John 3:16 relationship? That God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that me, whosoever, that means me, believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God gave until it hurt. He loved us so much. We wasn't in real good shape either. We're not talking about the Christian Jews or the Christians or everybody who had it together. He gave to the world so that the world could have life. So it gives us the opportunity to return his love in a genuine relationship. Prayer is also one of the places where God can get hold to us. We think that when we pray, we're trying to get hold of God, or I'm trying to get God's attention because I need something. But prayer is, when we communicate in prayer with God, God is really getting a hold to us. He's really getting a hold to us because we've been studying our word, reading our word, and just spending time meditating in him. We'll find out that a lot of times I really don't have much to say. God, I just need to be in your presence. Yeah. I just need to know that you're listening. I need to feel that you are there. So, God, here I am. You catch hold of me. Get hold of me. Sometimes I'm raggedy. Sometimes I'm broken. Sometimes I'm hurt. Sometimes I don't even feel like I'm worthy to call on his name. But if I stay there long enough, if I lay there long enough, I know he's going to contact me. I know he's going to come to my rescue. Because you see, I learned long time ago that when I go to him in prayer, I don't need to be doing all the talking. I learned that there's a reason. There's a reason I've got one mouth and two ears. That I should listen kind of twice as much as I speak. I've learned that I don't have to go to him and beg him. Because crying and begging and snotting and wiping tears and all that doesn't move him. You know what moves him? To me, I move him. He said, if you draw nigh to me, I will draw nigh to you. If you come to me, if you approach me, I'm coming back at you. So prayer gives God the opportunity to come back at me. I'm not always right when I go. And a lot of time when I go to God, I'm repenting for something. But it still gives him the opportunity to get back at me and get me right. How many of y'all know us Christians are not right all the time? That we miss the mark sometimes. That sometimes we step out of line and we get off track. And we need God to come put us back on the right road. So prayer gives us that opportunity for God to just reach out and grab us. Because sometimes we kind of get away from God. Especially when we sin and then messed up and don't know how to repent. We call ourselves hiding. Do you know that he's omnipresent? He's everywhere. We can't get away from him no matter where we go. If you don't believe that, read Psalms 139. There's no way I can go to get away from him. So I might as well stop running. I may as well stop hiding. Only thing I need to do is pray. Pray. And it's not always with my mouth. Pray means I get into a position and I listen to God and I listen for him to speak. And if there is an opportunity for me to say something, I got something to say because I've been reading his word. So I know how to talk his language. I know how to respond to him. But I don't always have to do all the talking. Because you see, the blessing is coming from him. The only thing I can bless him with is me. And I can't even change me if I want to. You know, sometimes we try to dress up, fix up, make up, and do all that trying to change me. But God, you made me. You put me in my mother's womb. You knew what I was going to be. You knew what I was going to turn out to be. You knew I was going to mess up, but you also knew you were going to bring me back in line. So this is me. Here I am again. You know me. The opportunity, y'all, of prayer. And y'all, everybody don't get that. That's not for the world. They don't want to have conversation with God. They don't want to spend time with God. Those who are out there in the world and don't have a mind to serve God, they don't want, they're running and hiding. And they don't take advantage of this opportunity. But I'm telling you, prayer is a great opportunity for all of us Christians who are here today. Not just a national day of prayer, not just a global day of prayer, but 365 days, 24 hours a day is a time of prayer. So it shouldn't be called the global day of prayer, but just global prayer, because people all over ought to learn how to pray and enter into the presence of God. Now there is a verse from 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14. And most of us Christians know that one by heart. Y'all don't even have to open y'all Bibles for that. We just kind of know that one by heart. And I'm going to read it. That scripture says, if my people, this is God talking back to Solomon. The chapter before that, Solomon is going to God and said, God, you know, we're kind of a people and we sometimes mess up. And when you bless these people with the promised land, I mean, you bless these people with this beautiful temple here. If they go a whoring after other gods, and if they mess up, would you forgive them? Would you put them back right with you? Yeah. So Solomon was kind of, you know, going before God and saying, God, you know, I've been dealing with people for all these years, and I just know people. They tend to mess up. But God, even if they mess up and forget all the promises and the benefits of who you are, would you forgive them if they repent? Would you do that? And so after having this long, drawn-out conversation with God, you see, Solomon was up in God's face. There was another man that I like to read about that was up in God's face. He wasn't ashamed to tell God just how he felt, and that was Moses. Moses said, okay, God, now come on, get it together. Now, you know if you do this, you know if you bring these people out and allow all of them to die in the wilderness, do you know what the people around the world are going to think about you? Do you know what they're going to say about you? They're going to say, oh, yeah, he brought them out. But he wasn't able to take them into the promised land. Moses had that kind of prayer relationship with God. Solomon had that prayer relationship with God. And so after going on for a while, God finally said, okay, Solomon, my turn. And God says, this is just the deal, Solomon. If my people, my people, not the world, not those who don't want any parts of me, but if my people, now you know who that's talking about, right? Us, the church, the body of Christ, the believers, our brothers, our sisters, those that are born again, that group, the ones that get prepared to go to church and try to live the best kind of life they can. He said, if my people, because that's who we're talking about, we're not talking about the world. If my people, you know, the ones who are called by my name, the ones that call on my name, if my people who are called by my name, if they'll just humble themselves. Literally, he was telling Solomon, I can't do for them. I can't humble them because I want them to serve me because they want to serve me. I want them to serve me out of reverence, not because they're afraid that I'm a God that's not fair, or not they're afraid that I'm going to strike them down with lightning, or they're afraid that I'm going to do something to them. But I want them to just serve me for who I am. And to humble ourselves, we need to humble ourselves enough to get to know who he is. He said if they would humble themselves, that means before we go to God in prayer, there has to be humility. There has to be humility. You can't talk to God like Moses and Solomon did, and your life ain't right. They had a relationship with God. They wasn't hiding anything from God. He said, but if we humble ourselves, and when you humble yourself to pray, you're saying, hey, God, I need you. I need you. Yeah. If it's going to get fixed, if it's going to be right, if my children are going to act right, I need you to intervene. Yeah. If my community is going to get cleaned up, God, I need you to intervene. If the nation is going to get any better, God, I need you to intervene. I cannot do it. I need you to answer me. I need you to come grab me and come to my rescue. I'm not worthy of anything. You don't owe me no favors. You've already given me eternal life. When you allow your son to die on the cross. When I accepted Jesus the Christ as my Savior, eternal life began to live in me. And all that's living in me right now. But God, I need you to grab hold to me. Because I need you to do a work. So we have to go to him in humility. Humble themselves. He said, and then pray. And then pray. And you'll find out that most of the time, when you humble yourself, there's not very much to say. But what's that famous line that my pastor liked to use? God, I thank you. I thank you. You did it. You knew what I had need of. And you did it. And you fixed it. And I was back here worrying about it, and you had already worked it out. You just needed me to come to you. You just needed me to humble myself and come to you. Humble themselves and pray. And then when we pray, we need to seek his face. Not approval of the world. Not approval of anybody else. But we need to seek his face. We need to make sure his face is shining and his face is smiling down on us. You know why God's face shines? Because if we're in the right place, we can see our reflection there. We can see that. So we need to make sure that he's smiling and he's pleased with what I'm doing. He said, seek my face. And then he said, after you seek my face, y'all Christians, you've entered into my presence now. You're feeling pretty good. You done gone past the goosebumps. And now I'm talking to you and you can't even hear me speak, but I'm talking to you. And you don't have to speak, but you're getting revelation. And so now you know you've entered into my presence. Now, because you seek my face, he said, now I want you to turn from your wicked ways. Because you still don't have it right yet. Turn from your wicked ways. Romans 12 and 2 says, present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. And that's what we Christians do. We come before God and we present ourselves before him. He said, now, and that's just your reasonable service. You haven't done anything yet. You present yourself to me, and now I'm getting ready to do something for you, but you haven't done anything yet. You walked up into my presence, and I know it's because you want something, but you haven't done anything yet. So what he said, seek my face, turn from your wicked ways. I used to be offended. There's a scripture in the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians. I call it the love chapter. But at the bottom of that chapter, it says, when I was a child, I spake as a child, thought as a child, understood as a child, but when I became mature, or when I became a man, I put away childish things. When I was back there in my childhood, when I first started in ministry, I used to get so offended when preachers get up in the pulpit and talk to me like I was a sinner. Because I'm a Christian now. I don't sin. And I got offended. But I want y'all to know, I grew up. I put away childish things. And I know that whether I do it or not, there's ample opportunity every day for me to sin. It's a choice. Living holy is a choice. It is a lifestyle. And if you don't stay on top of it, you be done sin out your mouth before you know it. You be done sin in your thoughts before you know it. How do we remedy that? Prayer is the answer. So he says, turn from your wicked ways. He said, and when you do all that, he said, and then I'll hear from heaven. I'll send the word to release your blessing. I'll send the word to release your prosperity. And then I'll make sure you get your healing. I'll make sure you get your deliverance. I'll make sure your finances get healed. You don't go to God asking for finances to be healed when we're not doing the right thing with the little bit that we have. So we got to, you know, there's order, there's steps. And we got to make sure that we're walking in the right order. You go to God for healing. I mean, and expect him to heal you. Well, when you get it, what you going to do with it? Are you going to keep it to yourself? Or are you going to go and seek out some sick people and minister to them? Prayer. Prayer. There are three things I want to share with you today about prayer. Prayer identifies the people of God. Because the people of God pray. Matthew 6, and when you pray, don't use the vain repetition that the heathens do. That has already set us apart from the heathen. He said, because they think, you know, they need to be heard for their much speaking. He said, and when you pray, don't heap up a lot of phrases as the Gentiles do. Y'all know the Gentiles back then were considered the worst kind of sinners. He said, they think they're going to be heard for their many words. And don't be like them. He said, because your Father already knows what you have need of. That's why I tell y'all, when we go into the presence of God, we got to have the right mindset. We can't fool him. And praying them pretty prayers and know there's something different in our heart. A lot of time when we go to God, we need to clean out the stuff out of our heart before we are qualified to ask him for anything. He already knows the thing that you have need of before you ask him. He says, so after this manner, this is the way you should pray. Abba, Father. Our Father. You know what that establishes? Relationship. I'm your child and you're my Father. So prayer establishes and identifies the people of God. Psalms 91 says, if you dwell in the secret place of the Most High, you'll abide under the shadow of the Almighty. That identifies your position in God, that you are God's people. Psalms 27 said, God is my light. He's my salvation. Who shall I fear? Even in a dark world, it says, when the wicked, when my enemies come upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumble and fall. Do you know why? Because I'm God's lady. You're God's man. That's why they can't touch me like they want to touch me. He said, there's one thing that I desire of the Lord, and that is what I'm going to seek after. I just want to dwell in his house. I just want to be in his presence. I just want to know that I know how to enter in when I really need to enter in. That is what I need to know. Romans 10 reminds us that all we need to do is believe with our heart. Confess with our mouth. And then we'll be what? My people. We'll be a Christian. We'll be saved. And he says, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves, pray and seek my face. The 13th verse of that 10th chapter said, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That means your status has just changed. Your status has just changed. Second thing I want to talk to you about, prayer, is that prayer manifests the purpose of God. It will manifest the purpose, the very reason that you were created, female, male, white, black, whatever. It manifests the presence of God. Paul says in the 3rd chapter of Ephesians, this is the reason that I bow my knees, verse 14, before the Father, to whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being. What is the purpose? To we be strengthened, with the inner man be strengthened. Prayer manifests the purpose of God. He wants us to be strong in his might. He wants us to wear the whole armor because the enemy is always looking after us. Jeremiah chapter 29, 11 says, I know the plans that I have for you. Plans for welfare and not for evil. To give you a future and to give you a hope. But in your spare time, go to the beginning of that chapter and read it. Because the scene is the nation of Israel is the children of Israel in captivity under the Babylonians. I mean, and they're treating them real bad. And they got some false prophets in the midst. And the false prophets are telling them, well, if you do this, we're going to get on up out of here. And if you do it this way, we can get on up out of here. When God divinely assigns a place for you, nobody can change it. Nobody can change it. It may be a hard place. It may be a place that you never would have chosen. But if God designed that place for you to be there, nobody else can get you up out of there. So Jeremiah had to send a letter to them and tell them to stop listening to them lying prophets saying that you're going to be here a couple of years and then you're going to get up out of here. Jeremiah sent them a letter and told them, this is what I want you to do. Relax. If you're in a place where you don't want to be, take it easy. Relax. You're going to be here for a while. This is your faith. But this is what I want you to do. You know, like a lot of people go to jail and they're worse off when they come out. That's because they do all the time that they're in there, they're mad, they're angry, they're upset, and they're blaming the reason that they're on everybody else. And God said, now, I don't want you to do that. This is what I want you to do. I want you to go ahead on and get married. And have children. Make sure you get married first for the children. Have children. He says that I want you to plant gardens. and I want you to build houses. And I want you to live like you got some sense and not like the heathen that they think you are. They treat you the way you act. He said, I want you to plant gardens. And they said, okay, well, since we're going to be here, we'll do that. But this is what he said. He said, then this is what I want you to do. I want you to pray for those that have you in captivity. Wow. That's a tough one, isn't it? You mean they treat me this bad and I'm supposed to pray for them? Yes. And you know what else God said? You can't fool me. You can't say a quick prayer because you think I'm listening. And you want me to hear because it one of them eloquent prayer. He says, when you pray to the point that it moves me to bless them. That's real. When you pray to the point that you make me bless them, this is what God is saying. He's got a sense of humor. That you move me to bless them, he says, then I'm going to bless you. He says, because I already know the plans I got for you. I already know that I'm going to bless you, that you're going to have an expected end, good and not evil, to give you peace. I already know that, but you got to line up if you want to walk in this blessing. You can't just come to me just because your name is so-and-so or just because you know somebody else. You got to line up for this thing. And I caught hold of that thing years ago. I said, so now I can't pray any phony prayers anymore. Because God, you don't listen to what I say. You listen to what I do. You listen to what I do. So I can't pray phony prayers anymore. So he says, pray, pray, pray. Yeah, you know that one you don't like? Pray for him. Pray for him till you like him. You know that one that you avoid? Pray for him. You know that one that you don't want to do nothing for him? Go bless him and then pray for him. Pray for him because you're holding up your own blessing. You got to break up brakes on me. I want to bless you. You know, I'm a God that bless. And I want to bless you, but you got the brakes on. Because you got an attitude. And you think you're better than they are. And you think you're higher and mightier than they are. And you think because you got a little bit of Bible knowledge and they might be illiterate, that you're better than they are. He said, no. If they can't read you, read to them. Yes. So we can't pray phony prayers anymore. So we don't need to wait till the global day of prayer. It needs to just be global prayer every day. Okay. I'm going a little bit long, but it's all right. The third thing, I'm going to cut it. The third thing, prayer brings about the promises of God. The promises. If he said he was going to do it, he's going to do it. He promised he was going to save us. Romans chapter 10 said, if we call on his name, he'll save us. He promised that he was going to heal us. James reminds us the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. So we got to start back anointing with oil and praying for the sick, and he said that they would be healed. If he promised that he was going to deliver us, he's going to deliver you. He promised that your children and your children's children will be saved. Even if they're out there acting like a fool, you don't need to worry about how they're acting. You need to worry about what the God that's going to save them said. And he said, I'm going to save them. He said, it's my desire that all be saved and none be lost. So we don't need to be stressing ourselves out, but we need to be praying. We don't need to give up and throw in the towel, not on ourselves, not on anybody else, but we need to enter into the mode of prayer and say, God, here I am today. I didn't come for nothing for me today, but would you bless Brother Reinhardt today? Would you bless the bishop today? Would you bless Sister Jones today? Would you just bless them because they're going through? Would you help them today? And you'll be surprised that when you leave the presence of God, and you get back down to earth, because y'all know we can't stay that long. When you get back down to earth, he's already worked your situation out. That thing that you don't even ask for, it's already there. Did not he tell us he would give us the desires of our heart? That means I don't have to verbally tell him what's in my heart. I just need to worship him. I just need to praise him. I just need to put myself in a place where when I call him, he'll tell me, come on.
Yes, right.
You can come closer. Come on.
Yeah.
I already know. Yeah. You don't have to beg me for a thing. I just love you so much. I want to bless you with this. And all that other stuff, you don't need to worry about that. Don't let it even get in your path. Put it aside. It don't matter. say, bump that. I'm the ultimate physician. They are practicing. It doesn't matter about that house that you lost. I got a better one for you. It doesn't matter about that relationship that didn't last. God is saying it wasn't love in the beginning. It was not. So don't worry about stuff like that. Take it and move it to the side. Because I got a better plan for you. I got a better plan for you. And I already know what I got planned for you. I got a better plan for you. Prayer. Manifest the promises of God. All you got to do is tap into it. Tap into it. And guess what? That little thing that you're going through, that little thing, Romans, 1 Corinthians 10 and 13, you know what it says? You're not the only one. There is no temptation taken unto you, but such as is common to everybody else. You're not the only one. So don't have a pity party and don't attend pity parties. God is not there. God is not at pity parties. And as soon as you leave the pity party, you can get your blessing. But as long as you stay in them pity parties and hang around pitiful people, you got the brakes on. You got the brakes on. Y'all, we are praying people. Prayer is a gift that God has given us. And it's so powerful, so powerful that we can walk in prayer. We can talk in prayer. You can be praying all, you can be in a prayer mode all day long. Sometimes I get to hollering in the house and my children come running, but what is wrong with you? Oh, nothing, I'm just praying. God just spoke to me and I had to hoop and holler. All right. In his presence, his fullness of joy, at his right hand, a pleasures forevermore. You have a gift, my brothers and my sisters. The body of Christ has a gift. It operates with the Holy Spirit. It operates with the Word of God. It operates with your sister and brother on the left side. It operates with your sister and brother on the right side. You got to get connected so that prayer can go up. And then when God says, oh, yeah, that Sylvia down there. Oh, yeah. You know, I already know what she needs. But I just needed to hear her voice today. We talking about hearing from God. God said, I need to hear her today. I need to hear Brother Ryan. I need to hear from him. I need to hear from him because the enemy has been weighing him down. And I just need to hear. I just need him to cry out my name. I just need to hear him say, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. The power of prayer. It is a gift to the body of Christ. Let's continue. It's men and women of God to celebrate the power of prayer. It's global. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord, everybody. Now, wasn't that a powerful message? I want to tell you, before I came to serve God, this is my mother here. Before I found God, I used to come to her. I used to talk to her and tell her what's on my mind. It was not a time when I could not go to her. She said, Brother Ryan, what's wrong? I need you to pray for me. You see, through everything that I've been through, she's been there with me. She know me better than I know myself. We just want to thank her for this message. Now, ladies and gentlemen, this comes the time of our service where we call to you. As you know, earlier, we read our missionary statement, the Victory Ecumenical statement, what it stands for, the reason, the part where we call you to membership. This morning, if you do not have a church home that you can call your own, you do not have a church that you can go voice your opinion, a church where you can go volunteer. You see, this is the part of the service where I call to you and invite you to come on down. If you are not part of a church family and you've been looking for one, we have one right here, and we welcome you. At this time, we all stand. If you're in need of a church home, you're in need of prayer, you're in need of a blessing, or asking God for something, this is the time. Y'all stand, please.
Come to Jesus.
Come to Jesus.
Just now. Just now. Come to Jesus.
Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Just now. Just now, just now, come to Jesus, just now. Amen. So I assume everybody had the church home. Now, we're going to ask Pastor Sylvia to come pray.
Thank you, Father. Thank you for these thy people. You know what we stand in need of.
Yes, Lord.
You know where we are.
Yes, Father.
I thank you that you are approachable.
Yes.
We can draw nigh to you, and we can expect that you would draw nigh to us. But I pray a special covering over the people that are under the sound of my voice today.
Yes, Lord.
Just a special covering, Father. Just don't know what's ahead, but just a special covering that you would keep them in perfect peace, with their minds stayed on you. I thank you right now for touching mind, bodies, hearts, souls, and spirits. I thank you for encouraging them in their spirit. But most of all, I thank you for opening the eyes of their hearts, that they can see you in every situation and in every circumstance. These are your people, Father, and we love you, and some of us love you the best way that we know how. If anything that we're lacking or anything that we're missing, you love us enough to show us. And we thank you for that, that you would not allow us to continue to go astray. But as I bless them this day, Father, hear from heaven, send down a special blessing on each and every one of them, not only those that are here, but those that are all over gathering in your name. And bless this day, Father. Bless this ecumenical church.
Yes, Lord.
That they will continue to bring in lives and refine them, so that they can be used for your kingdom.
Yes, Lord.
That they can continue to give others a second and a third chance.
Yes.
Most of all, that they can do the work that you've called them to do and fulfill the purpose that you've created them. Thank you, Father.
Thank you.
For another day of Pentecost.
Yes.
That we celebrate the birthday
of
the one and only true church. The one that names the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Yeshua HaMashiach. We give you glory, honor, praise, thanksgiving in the mighty name of Yeshua, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Thank you so much, preacher. You know, I am somewhat of a critic. I'm listening and I'm hearing, but I'm weighing things in my mind as to whether they are true or not. So I've heard this message today. Maybe you're weighing this. Maybe you're thinking about, is she really telling the truth? Let me give you my testimony. I was downtown one day and someone said to me that Pastor Sylvia was under the weather. I said, oh, is that so? They said, yes, she's gone to Charleston to the hospital. I said, oh, is that so? So yes, we were going to have prayer with her, but she was gone. So I said, well, I'll wait until she returns. And I will go and sit with her and talk with her and have prayer with her. Well, she did return to the city. And I went by her home because the way the person described her, she was so sick. She was hurting so badly. But I knocked on the door for quite a while and no one answered. And so the ministry is just a ways up the street. So I said, well, let me run over there. Maybe she just stopped in for a moment. So I went over to the ministry and she was standing there at the pulpit and she was just going, I said, man, she was feeling so good and looking so good and praising God, and she was running from this side, running to that side. So, you know, I got a cell phone. I pull out my cell phone. I call the person. I said, I thought you told me she was sick. I said, well, she is sick. She went to the hospital. I said, well, I don't see any signs of sickness. All I see is signs of praise and prayer. Now, I want you to know that I learned something from that. Now, I don't know her condition, but just to look at her, she looked pretty good to me. I said, if ever I should think I'm sick in my mind, I'm going to praise God and be in a conversation where I won't let him go. Because I want to be like Pastor Sylvia. I want to be running here and there. Let's give her a praise. Amen. Amen. It's time for us to go. We're just a little bit late, but I wanted to give you all an opportunity to say something. If you had something on your mind, something pressing that you needed to say, any announcements this morning? We have anybody we need to recognize this morning. Brother Reinhardt, do you have anybody you wanted to recognize this morning?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Please.
Hi, everybody. I want to recognize my sister and my brother-in-law, Cynthia Reinhardt from Greensboro, North Carolina. Please stand. I want to let her know that I love you. I can't do without you. And this is my sister that I done came a long way. I done did a lot of things. She never turned her back on me. And I thank God for it. Thank you.
Is there anyone else? Anyone else? Well, we're going to leave this place now. We're going to Christ Central to have dinner or lunch. And we will reassemble here at 3:30, 3:45. And Reverend Tutisim Tuning will be our host pastor for the afternoon service. We will start promptly at 4 o'clock, praise and worship a half hour before. And sometimes we think praise and worship is just somebody on an organ or the drums and just making a lot of noise. But I'm learning today that praise and worship is being in the type of prayer that Pastor Sylvie was talking about. But so we'll do that this afternoon. Reverend Tunning, won't you come and greet us and let us know what we're in store for this afternoon? Come quickly.
Praise God, everybody.
Praise God.
I want to thank you again for being here this morning and this afternoon, 4 o'clock service, we'll have our annual ordination for the Ecumenical Church of Christ. And this is a service where we are going to recognize some people that have been set aside, not by us, but by God himself. And this is a service that I partake to about 3 years ago. And I remember one thing that late Reverend Dr. Cunningham said that day. He said, if you could not heal anybody before, you're not going to heal anybody after your ordination. So, but it's going to be a very exciting time. We have a delegation coming from Atlanta, Georgia. Is that correct? And I wanted to recognize them this morning, and with the blessing of the pastor of First Ecumenical Church, I thank all of you for making the sacrifice to come all the way down there to down here to fellowship with us. And I was just so overwhelmed this morning, just smelling the food. And but this is going to be a very exciting service. And following that service, we're going to have another dinner back at Christ Center. And I call it a Cameroon dinner. Now, Pastor Sylvia, you must not miss this dinner, please. She's asking if we have the peanut chicken. But this is going to be a very exciting moment, and I thank you for being with us this morning. I pray that you will join us back at 4 o'clock for this great celebration of the life and the legacy of Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen. We're going to have the benediction given by Reverend Tunning, but I wanted to share something else that Reverend Ted Cunningham said. A lot of you I've had conversations with about being in the ministry. And someone went and gave someone an invitation to come to their ordination, said, please come. And the person looked at them and said, oh my God, you? You? Said, something must be wrong. But Reverend Cunningham told us that God does not call the qualified. He qualifies the ones he calls. Somebody say amen. Amen. Won't you stand? Please.
Now that we are about to leave this place, but never his presence, we pray, Father, that we are leaving this place filled with the Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray your blessing upon each and every one of us here this morning. Lord, I pray healing on each and every one of us this morning here, Lord. Yes. Lord, now we're leaving this place, Father, but we are never leaving your presence. Yes. Go in the peace and the love of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord and Savior. Go and serve God mightily. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.